The use case that we're doing here today is tokenization of ownership in companies and investment. You know, you might argue you can do that with paper, right? But yeah. But it's more it's more efficient doing that with a digital token.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Are we ahead? There's different jurisdictions all over the world, and they all have their pros and cons. But what's unique about what we're doing here with the two tokens is that we're actually doing it in real companies, you know, and show that we can do it today.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, I'm really happy that we're able to show that, because I think that's really valuable for everyone to learn.
Absolutely.
About this. So, yeah. Thanks, Alex. Yeah. And let's move over to Marleen. Marleen, you're working with NextChange already on the next generation of capital markets. And this is a really cool project, I think, that you're working out to use tokenization to take it to the next level.
Yeah, absolutely.
Please tell us more.
Yes, with two tokens, we sat together and we thought about like how can we really add value to the market, and we decided to develop a new financial structure and a new ecosystem for promoting and financing sustainability towards the future. It's a very important topic. And because two tokens selected us as a use case, we are also going to document that on how we are doing that. And for that, we are organizing all these webinars. Yeah. And we are going way more into detail on how everything is structured, not only from a technical perspective, but also from a legal and a regulatory perspective. And for that, we're sitting here today. And we're going to talk about regulation and token economics. Really interesting cases are going to be discussed. And the next masterclass will be about the legal structure of the ventures that are going to be financed and how they are going to be financed. So we're going to touch all different kinds of topics. Masterclasses can be reviewed. And obviously, we are always available for questions, but we love like the interaction during these masterclasses as well.
Well, thanks. That's good for everyone to know that indeed we're really trying to create an educational perspective here. And please reach out if you feel that topics are missing or more information is required.
Absolutely.
So it's a good reach out.
So
we get started.
Absolutely. Financing sustainability. That is a. There are loads of opportunities in the Netherlands. We have some of the greatest tech universities. Developing technology to improve our sustainable level, but financing these ventures bring in some challenges. It's mostly about new technology, which we don't completely understand, at least the non-technical people, and it's also mostly about new ventures. Startups, scale-ups that are very the use cases or the financials or the investments needed to finance this are mostly don't fit the investment mandate of the institutional investors.
No, most people think about financing wind farms and solar farms rather than new technology startups that are actually should create the next generation of technology.
Yes, right? Absolutely. Yeah. So for that we created a new financial structure. And this structure is, we call it the next generation capital vertical. And this structure is a virtual basket of ventures in which you can invest. It's offered to the market as a bundled investment offer.
Yep.
And where we standardize everything. We standardize documentation. We standardize the governance. We standardize the way the securities are structured, which make it all very transparent and clear. It gives the investor the possibility to diversify in its investment over multiple ventures. In this case, 30 ventures. And what is very important, every vertical is managed by a program manager that has a proven track record in this tech sector. And we've selected for Next Gen Capital, we've selected two. One is HiTech Excel, and the other one is Yes Delft.
Nice. So I think it's really interesting because it brings a couple of themes together, like theme investing, right? So people that want to go for sustainability and want to put their money there, as well as venture investing, like crowdfunding, for example. It actually puts it all together on a solid, mature infrastructure, it feels like.
Yes, and I think what's the newest feature to it is that you actually have a player that is very involved has an ecosystem. If you take Hightech Excel, for example, Hightech Excel has Philips and ASML as their main shareholders. They have an enormous ecosystem that can educate these ventures, that can monitor the technology, that can monitor the progress of these ventures. And for that, we hope to see that we bring together all what's needed in a new investment opportunity.
Yeah. You have some information for us, I think, right?
Yeah, and so we do these investments, and later on, Claire is going to more into more details about how this offering will take place. What's unique about the investment offering is that it's a bonded investment offer for multiple investments into these ventures up until their Series A level. Dus these ventures, these 30 ventures, they do an initial IPO altogether. And when they reach certain milestones, they will get another investment round, which is pre-agreed up front. Investors know against which valuation they are going to invest. They know how the whole dilution works. And the venture just knows that they can focus on reaching that milestone, because once they've reached that milestone, they will get another round of funding, and the investors will get another bucket of shares. What's unique is that you, as an investor, you get a diversified investment. You can invest in a virtual basket of ventures. Yep. And in the secondary market, you can trade both the ventures, but also the vertical. Okay. And that is something new. And for that, we've done the deal today to elaborate more on that, on how we use new technology to make this possible, and how we are actually doing that.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting, because you have indeed these different sort of existing familiar concepts, but you tie them together in a way that is unfamiliar and unprecedented, I think. So that's definitely interesting to learn more.
Yes,
more
and about. Yeah. And very important, everything within our existing regulatory framework. We are all very heavily regulated bodies. An exchange is a regulated market, and MTF. We have to comply with MiFID II, with the current regulations. And we use new technology to do what we do, but only better.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. I think it's really interesting to learn more about that. I think, can you just say a little bit about the role of the partners that you work with, right? So they guide the companies themselves. They're in a sort of a program together.
Yes.
And at the same time, they are also acting on behalf of the investors.
Yes. We've selected two partners, or program managers, we call them, Hightech Excel and Yes Delft, both venture builders and accelerators. And what these partners do is they scout technology over the whole world, and they scout talent, and they either build ventures or they accelerate ventures.
Yeah.
And they bring them from what we call an investment world, an investor readiness level between 1 and 8, and in a technology readiness level between 4 and 7,
okay,
all within 24 months. And they've set up whole programs to do that. And they already do this currently, also without the vertical. The only difference is that they now also arrange the financing of these ventures. Because what normally happens is these ventures, they start, they get developed, and then the issue of funding takes place, for which we don't really have a system in the Netherlands.
No.
We call it the Valley of Death. And now we're trying to fill that, to resolve that, and to come up with a new structure to make sure that we can actually keep that technology within the Netherlands. We can keep the ownership, hopefully, within the Netherlands. But most of all, that we do these developments, which are so necessary for our future, for our children's generation. So,
I think that's really, really nice to actually solve that, because it's a well-known challenge that indeed a lot of entrepreneurs suddenly have to become an investment expert right after starting their company, which is very tough game.
And instead of being focused on developing their technology, then most of the founders are 80% of their time they're busy with raising capital.
Yeah.
If successful or not at all, and then they just disappear, which is...
Exactly. Yeah. No, so really curious to learn a bit more about this, because I think it's a really great initiative. So let's see if we can get Claire at the table to talk more about the legal side of this.
Yes, because the legal side is complex. The regulatory side is also new. We we challenged and what's very nice of the Two Tokens initiative is that not only lawyers, technology providers are part of, but also the AFM is taking place in this initiative, and it's a joint collaboration where we are actually creating this, where there's a dialogue between us and the regulator, to build this and to create a structure that hopefully also has a future, not only for these two verticals, but also for other initiatives that need to be financed in the future.
Yep.
And Claire is very knowledgeable about everything that has to do with financial regulation. And yeah, hopefully she can explain a little bit more on what this vertical means. Everybody, especially in all the worldwide developments around tokenization, security tokens, it's all about, oh, we have to change the regulation, we have to change the law. And that's actually what we not did. So I think it's good if Claire also explains a little bit on how we see security tokens and what we are actually doing with it from a regulatory point of view.
Yeah. Indeed. Well, Claire Wermers, very much welcome. You're a lawyer at CMS, and you're very deep into this topic and helping out this project. I think it's a really great, really great job. I'd love to talk to you a little bit more about how you see this developing, and especially also, I think, the relationship with the regulators, how that's evolving, especially, I think, in the field where you're not trying to do something new. But you probably also have to explain that from time to time, that you're actually not trying to do something new.
No. No, exactly. We try to fit it into the existing regulatory framework.
Yeah, so how did you get into this this project? When did you start on this, working on this?
I think a few months ago, when Two Tokens started to support this use case. I'm an advisory board member of Two Tokens.
Yeah.
And I'm really interested in security tokens, tokenization of security. So I think it's a great initiative, and it creates great potential for all parties involved, actually.
Yeah. I think it's really, really interesting indeed, because there's a lot of mystery around it, right? So we see it's very often tied into the deep into the cryptocurrency world, where of course we've seen quite some regulatory challenges and issues, as well as that we saw that markets, of course, have been very volatile. And so I think it's really nice that we're actually just talking at this from a different perspective, and trying to do that within the existing legal regulatory framework.
Yes.
What does that entail? So what did you have to do to actually make sure it fits?
What we are doing in the project, security tokens will be issued, and there are no specific rules for security tokens. We just see how they fit into the existing legal framework, and they have the characteristics of security, so that's why we also treat them as securities.
Yep.
If you offer securities to the public in Europe, you need to have an approved prospectus. In the Netherlands, the AFM will approve a prospectus, but there are also very useful exemptions. For instance, if the offer does not exceed 5 million, you do not have the full prospectus, but you can have an information document and provide certain information to the AFM. The ventures will probably make use of that exemption. And it's the vertical as such is no legal entity. It's a group of companies selected by the program manager, it does not have rights and obligations. The ventures that together form the vertical, they do have rights and obligations.
Yep.
They are legal entities. So it's not our intention to create an investment fund where you have a participation in a fund, and where you have a fund manager that will invest your money in accordance with a certain investment policy. It's not, from a legal perspective, the vertical is nothing. You will not have a participation in the vertical, but you will have an interest in the ventures that together form the vertical.
Yeah. But the more traditional way of solving this problem would be indeed to set up a fund structure.
Yes, right? Exactly. Yeah. But there you have the AIFMD license, and that's not how this is structured. But it is structured in the existing legal framework, because when we list the vertical, it will not be one IPO, but it will basically be the IPO of all the ventures that together form the vertical. So yep. If there are 25 ventures, there will be 25 IPOs, and each venture will have its own prospectus or information document to fully comply with all the existing regulations.
So it's a bit of a collective mandate from the investor, right, to invest in multiple ventures with one mandate.
Yes.
So that's, I think, it's a really interesting one.
Yes.
And how does that work?
But only in the primary market.
Okay.
Because, an advantage of this structure is that we can use standardized documentation. So each venture will have the same articles of association, which makes it very cost and time efficient.
Yep.
So in the primary market, it's only possible to invest in all ventures for the same amount. So it's not possible to tailor your portfolio and select a few ventures. In the secondary market, it's possible to unbundle this single investment and to say, because they are all individual listed companies, I would like to increase my interest in a specific venture.
Okay. I think that's really interesting to see. It's basically, but let's say, where's the difference from a legal perspective? Does it mean that especially the investment mandate is something that's based on the collective for the first for the primary market, and that after that investment has been executed, mm-hmm. that from then on these are individual investments, right? Is that sort of the perspective how to look at it?
Yes, and it's more a combined IPO, so to say.
Yeah.
What's really nice about it is that in the secondary market, next to only trading the separate ventures, you can also still trade the vertical as such.
Okay.
So you can do both. You can either, and which you would not be able to do within the fund, which is a lot more rigid. Mm. You invest in a fund, and you have to wait until you get some return on investment. But in this structure, you can decide on how you allocate your portfolio, which ventures you would like to be invested in. There will be investors that just buy and hold. And only trade the vertical, and there will be investors that might want to trade single ventures on their own, or that want to reshift the focus, because these ventures are all ventures in sustainability, but a percentage might be in healthcare, a percentage might be in clean tech, and especially in the whole ESG framework, there are certain investors that have a certain focus, and therefore they can reallocate their investment.
I think so. And so what role, and maybe I'm not sure who to ask, but maybe you could both give your perspective, is what role do the tokens play to facilitate this? Because generally these structures tend to be relatively expensive, right? If you would do this in a traditional way, that's why normally mostly larger companies would get listed and work with similar structures. Mm-hmm. How do you solve the cost issue around this?
Well, I think by only offering the combined investment on the primary market, because there you have the standardization, and all ventures will have the same milestones and the same standard documentation, and that creates efficiency, cost efficiency.
Yeah. And also from a governance point of view, it will be a very transparent structure, very simple structure, and that hopefully not only the professional investors understand, but also the larger public understands.
Yeah, I think it makes it really appealing where indeed you can sort of, let's say, a lot more people have become interested in investing through things like crowdfunding, but indeed you can take that to a more professional level now by actually looking at...
In a way, every exchange is a form of crowdfunding, but I think what makes this special is that you have a secondary market where you can actually trade your investment, where you don't need to wait until the venture has a certain exit. Will it be a very liquid market? Probably not in the beginning. However, because we can trade both the basket as or the vertical as well as the separate ventures, there will be some activity, probably more than when you would have one venture that would be listed on the market. So, and that I think Dion will later on also go into.
Yeah, definitely. Interesting to see about that. So. Yeah, maybe indeed to tell a little bit more about the role of the program manager, because I think it's interesting to see, let's say it's quite a unique role, right? So it's not a fund manager, so they're in there from the financial management perspective, but they're helping these ventures to go, but at the same time they have this role towards the investors as well. Can you explain a little bit about their role?
Yes, well, at the beginning of the journey, they will select the ventures. So they will select the ventures that will together form the vertical. But the ventures will be in control over their own business. But the program manager will support them with their knowledge and their network. And what is, a specific of this structure is that in the primary market, there's not only one IPO. There are also subsequent financing rounds, three rounds. And the investor in the primary market will already make available the funding also for these subsequent financing rounds. If the venture complies with the has reached the milestone, the program manager has an important role because the program manager will assess if the venture has reached the milestone. Additional securities will be offered and the funding becomes available. So that's an important role of the program manager.
Yeah, so they really validate those milestones therefore communicate, probably also part of the communication with investors about that.
Yes, right? They will check. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's quite unique. I think we've seen various accelerator programs be involved in, supporting their companies to get financing.
Yes.
Some very successful, like Y Combinator, for example, and some less successful. But I think it's really interesting to see how they can extend their role there and facilitate their companies on the longer run.
Yes.
Especially if it's more societal theme-based, like sustainable investing, for example.
Yes, and that also enables the ventures to really focus on their business.
Yeah. 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 I think it's...
I'm curious, Donna, if there are like any questions from the viewers. I don't know if...
Me too. I'm also curious to see if there are already people that have questions around here. I couldn't see anyone come by yet, but we're checking here with
free to ask questions because yes. this is definitely a place to share information and to ask the relevant
exactly we're trying to give a good overview, but of course there might be things that are unanswered or questions that pop up. So are the program managers, are they also investing in the companies themselves? Are they involved somehow in the structure?
Yes, they will have an interest in the ventures, also to align their interest with the interest of the investors. And they will also have a blocking vote, but only for a limited number of matters that really could harm the position of the investors.
Okay. Okay, yeah, from that perspective, it's really looked after the position of the investors in the relation of this, so that they actually have a good position and they act on their behalf and that indeed the interests are aligned.
Yes, but the investors will have, the same investor rights as a regular listed company. They will have voting rights, dividend rights.
Okay. Yeah, so indeed, it's the actual shares, not just economical rights like certificates subscribed shares. Yeah.
And I think the structure, but Dion will explain in more detail, also makes it very easy how you can optimize that governance structure. Yeah. So how you can vote and how you can actually exercise the rights you have as an investor.
Okay, yeah, that's really interesting to dive into as well. Yeah, but it's, thanks. Is there anything else we missed, Claire, that you think we should should let the viewers know about?
I think it's a really a great new way of funding, which is based on, existing regulation. So if questions come up, please let us know. Happy to answer them.
I do have one more, and that's the relationship with the regulator, right? So on one end, you try to make use of the existing regulatory framework.
Yes.
But we also know that sometimes regulators can be, they're always trying to look whether you're actually indeed still within the law. How does that relationship, how's that evolving, and how are they involved in the project?
I think that's also their role. They, especially if you have a structure like this, which is new, or certain aspects are new, they are involved in a way that we share our view on how we see the qualification. We do not see this as an investment fund, but as a multiple bundled offer of multiple ventures.
Yep.
But we are in contact with the regulator on this, and happy to explain our view on how we qualify the structure.
Yeah. Do you find that they're generally constructive conversations that you're having with them?
Yes, I mean,
are they interested to explore what these kind of structures could do for the market, for example?
Well, I think their focus is on how you comply with the legal framework, which is also their role as a supervisor. But they are definitely involved, and we had interesting discussions with them.
Okay.
Yeah. I think we have a question. Maybe Claire, you can.
Yeah, so one of the viewers says that there might be a conflict of interest between the program managers in this setup. So could you explain maybe a little bit, Claire, what do you think? I think this is about probably where indeed there might be a different, like a blocking vote on certain matters compared to the other investors. How sensitive is that, for example, for investors?
Well, I think that's not very sensitive because the program manager also is an investor, and that makes it that the interest of the program manager is aligned with the interest of the other investors. So I think in the governance structure we can describe this conflict of interest, and it's not that the program manager has a blocking vote on the business. It only looks at the interest of the investors.
Yes, okay. And the blocking vote that a program manager, for example, might have are things that might touch the setup of the vertical, for example, changing the statutes, the company statutes, or issuing new shares, because you pre-agreed with the investors on how that would take place. And those are things that are so sensitive, and for the timing of the vertical, the program manager can block that, not decide differently for the venture itself, but more just protect.
And so you talked then about the investment period, right? So when the companies are doing their IPOs, that's within a certain time frame?
Yes, and the companies, if we take, for example, High Tech Excel, there will be 30 ventures selected over a time frame of 3 years. And during those 3 years, the vertical is active. Companies develop into certain stages, that's it's a longer period of time.
Yeah. Okay. How will the dividends be paid out, in tokens or in euros? I see here. This could be.
Yeah. In this case, we chose to pay out in euros, but that's actually up to the company to decide how they want to pay out their dividend. Both would be possible, but in this case, it will be just a traditional dividend in euros, because if they would have been paid out in tokens, that would mean a new share issuance.
Exactly. So indeed, you could get share dividends like at regular companies, probably.
Yeah, it's exactly the same as how it would with the normal.
Good question.
Works.
Oh, we got another one. How can you start a similar structure in other countries, or does it need to be based in the Netherlands? That's an interesting one.
I think you can also structure it in other countries, but you should look at the legal framework that applies in that country. The prospectus rules are based on the European prospectus regulation, so in Europe it will be the same. But for instance, the 5 million exemption can be tailored by each member state. So you should really look at the local laws that apply in the country where you set up such structure, but also where you will approach the investors.
Yeah, okay. Clear. So I think, Europe, for example, is already very fragmented if you look into the sort of local differences.
Yes.
Do you expect that there might be trouble in specific countries to set something like this up, or would it be under the European framework, it should be fairly doable under these laws?
I think it should be doable, but you should really look at the location of your investors and the trading platform you will use for this, because also the trading platform needs to have the required licenses.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, clear. Maybe this is a nice question for you, Marleen. I see what the focus of the vertical.
Yes.
This is that's aimed for now, right? So it's aimed at sustainability as it's currently positioned. Are you exploring also other verticals, or how Maybe good to describe a bit how broad you see the sustainability vertical.
Yeah, so this structure could be used for any type of program. But in this case, we chose to apply it to the sustainability area. Why? Because of the reasons I just named. There's a lot of technological development. There are a lot of new ventures. And especially in that area, we just have a problem in the Netherlands that we don't get the right financial, the capital allocation towards this sector. Does that mean that we can use the same structure for, I don't know, another thematic-based vertical? No problem at all, because it's a very generic structure. Yep. And it ties into the securities law and the whole financial directive as for any other type of company.
Yeah, and so in principle, I could imagine that you say if we have other partners that are interested in collaborating on setting up another vertical,
yes,
for example, in healthcare, or to explore similar structures.
Yeah, in fact, we are also already doing that, but for next generation capital, it's purely focused on sustainability.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Then another one for you, Claire. What disadvantages do you see in the Dutch legislation in particular?
Well, I think often the focus is on changing the law or the disadvantages, but I think the majority of the laws we have is based on European legislation, and it's not easy to change. So I think you should not focus on the disadvantages, but on the possibilities. And I think in this structure, the 5 million exemption, for example, creates a great opportunity, because each venture can attract up to 5 million, which is very useful. Maybe for the future you can look at changes to the legislation, but for now we can have this structure within the existing framework.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think that's really great that we're able to do it like that, and indeed that's probably also good to that the alignment with the regulators makes it easy if it actually fits well in the structure. Let's see, there's another question, but I'm not...
I think it's about what will happen for a subsequent investment round after the vertical.
Oh, yeah.
So what would happen to these ventures? They're now publicly listed, and they've reached a certain maturity in their development, they've reached their milestones, and they might need new capital.
Yeah.
And that's also something that we really dove into together with the program managers. So what is the typical life cycle of these ventures? A lot of these ventures, at some point in time, it's not. There's a reason, of course, why Philips and ASML are so close to high-tech Excel, because there might be technology that specifically comes for use for ASML, for example.
Yep.
And then there needs to be a way to buy the venture off the exchange as well. So upfront in the whole legal documentation, we take care that is possible, that there are certain rights to the investors, but also some rights to the ventures. That would be a possibility. Another possibility is that the venture would need to raise another capital round. And they can then do that on the exchange according to the existing rules. And that means if you raise more than 5 million in 1 year, you need to have an approved prospectus. Getting an approved prospectus is nothing, there's nothing wrong with that. It's actually very good.
Yeah.
All the documentation that we are creating already has the prospectus level. So these ventures will be raised, and they will be structured in a way that it would be very easy for them that if they have to raise the next capital round, that they don't have like complex term sheets with existing investors, that everything is set up in a way to make sure that they can go for another capital round, which might be way more substantial than the first, in this case, 1.2 million per venture that they are raising in the initial vertical rounds.
Yep.
So, and then they would need to have that prospectus.
All right. Yeah, I think this already clarified this question. Or anything to add here, perhaps, Claire?
We will use the 5 million exemption at the level of the venture and not for the vertical, because the vertical basically is nothing. It's a group of ventures.
But the total capital raise will be, in fact, 30 times 1.2 million.
Yeah.
So the total equity raise would be around a little bit less than 29 million in equity, and the rest is in debt. So we can also optimize the the financial structure that we apply to these ventures. So the, that makes it possible for also an institutional investor to consider such an investment, because if you only need to raise 1.2 million per venture, that's way too small for an institutional investor to consider. 29 million is even still very small, but it's in a very concentrated area, and you have a program manager with a proven track record where you can apply your DD on. So in that case, we hope to also make it possible for the institutionals to participate in this development.
Yeah. Is there a floor or a cap towards the investment per participant?
No, no. So every investment is equally distributed over the 30 ventures. And it doesn't matter where you, whether you invest 1,000 euros or 29 million, that will be equally distributed over the
Exactly,
over
but the there's no technical barrier there, or for example, what will be the share size per venture?
They will be very small.
Okay. I think in the current structure, the nominal value will be will have five zeros, so it will 0.00001 euro.
The reason for that is because we want to make sure that we do it, everything as efficiently as possible, that the ventures don't need to go to the notary every time they issue new shares. That's the startup capital is a capital that they actually can finance in the beginning. So there's a lot of thinking that went also into the structuring, which we are going to basically discuss next masterclass on how that is structured.
Yeah.
And because the nominal value is such a small amount, it's also very easy to pay up the shares.
Or yes, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, no, so that's of course very interesting.
Yes.
That's one of the things that you see in the stock market, that sometimes share prices go through the roof and actually certain groups of investors can't get in anymore. Maybe let's pick on the last question. How will duty of care come into play when private retail investors are able to invest in the vertical?
Well, the duty of care, they will be provided with sufficient information. There will be an information document, and because all the ventures will have the same articles of association, it will be very clear what the rights and obligations are of each party involved. So I think by doing that and having a real solid set of standard documentation, we can comply with the duty of care.
Yeah, and on top of that, legally, every retail investor goes to a broker, an exchange broker in this case. And we have certain obligations to make sure that these investors understand what they are investing in.
Yep.
But these are all very simple investment. It's plain equity. There's nothing structured against it. It's just simple shares in a company. So in the whole regulatory domain, that's the most simple security you can trade. So. But we would need to do the legal part of onboarding the retail investors as well.
Yeah, exactly. And I think then probably the program managers are the ones that have a certain information obligation, perhaps, on portfolio level, or does it all go with the individual companies?
It's the individual companies that have that obligation to provide that, because they are publicly listed to the exchange. And the program manager might assist with it, but it's the obligation of the venture itself.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's really clear. I want to thank everyone already for the questions so far, and keep them coming in if you have them, because if we are not able to answer them now, we might be able to answer you later, or make sure that we address them in one of the follow-on seminars.
Yes, absolutely.
So I think that would be great. Then I would like to thank you, Claire, for joining
thank
us
you.
Here. Looking forward to talk to you again soon. And I'd like to call Dion to join us for the next part of the conversation. Dion Bongaert is associate professor at the RSM, the Rotterdam School of Management, part of the Erasmus University. Welcome very much to the seminar and the show here.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, really looking forward. So you're deep into technology and finance, right?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, so how did you get involved into this project?
About 1.5 years ago, at our school, we started a research center on data analytics with different focus areas. We call them areas of expertise. And one of the areas of expertise is fintech. From my background in secondary securities markets, as well as econometrics, where a lot of algorithms are used, I ended up as academic director there, and then I got interested in blockchain, and that's how I ended up here.
Okay, yeah, really nice. So
absolutely.
Yeah, and I think it may be nice to let you start a little bit with explaining the structure behind the project that we're talking about right now, right? So would you like to kick that off?
Well, I think Marlene wanted to first explain how
because
trading and settlement system currently works.
Yep, sure.
Yeah, so to understand why tokenizing a security adds value, because in our current system, in our current framework, we can already very efficiently issue shares, we can make them tradable, we have very efficient capital markets. So why would we need a tokenized security? For what benefit? So for that, it's, I think before, because Dion has the most important information, so I'm going to go through this as quickly as possible. But we need to understand a little bit on how the trading, clearing, and settlement of a traditional security is done, especially for the people that don't have this this background in this area. And that basically comes to the following point. To go from one buyer to to a seller, you actually go, the security takes about 8 to 10 steps to go from a buyer to a seller, and it takes about 2 days to settle the transaction. And we have to take into account that there are multiple parties involved in this whole trading, clearing, and settlement process. So to change, it's you need all those parties involved to make that change happen. In the securities trading, clearing, and settlement world, there's actually one body that's very, very important, and I call it the god of the financial or the capital market, and that's the CSD, the Central Securities Depository. And most of the conversation about tokens or token technology go about like, who's the depository, and can I keep the token in my own wallet? It's not so much about where the token itself sits. The token can function as a sort of a password or whatsoever, but it's about what roles and responsibilities the CSD has. And it actually connects the token to the real asset that is behind it. It has to make sure that they, once the issuer wants to issue assets, that those assets flow into the financial system in a way that there are not more shares outstanding, for example, than there are in the books of the company. It has also registered ownership, because ownership constantly changes and moves over time. It has to take care of dividend payments, etc. So the Central Securities Depository is a key player in this whole ecosystem. It's also a key player if you want to move between brokers, for example. That's an interesting concept. We normally never need to change brokers because, yeah, we sit with one broker and we keep our shares in that account. But if we want to change from one broker to the other, it takes about 10 working days to move from one broker to the other. Why? Because it's all manual process. Everybody has to inform everyone to move those shares from one system to the other. And then don't even get started in moving shares that are offered on one exchange and then want to offer them on a second exchange. That's almost mission impossible.
Yeah, but you're talking about a lot of double administrations, actually, but people keep the information for different purposes, and that makes it also complex.
Yes, and that's where I have the next drawing for. All these layers, so the broker, the admitted institution, the exchange, the central counterparty, the CSD, they all report and they all administrate. And they all have to keep their own administration and they do their own reporting on their own towards the regulator. There's no integration between all those bodies. And that's why it's so complex to move from one venue to the other, because otherwise the whole the monitoring of the market doesn't work anymore. Or more importantly, there's one very large risk in the financial markets, and that's settlement risk. Yep. And that needs to be monitored and that needs to be taken care of. And that's why it's so complex to move in our current framework. And and that's where we think that the tokenization part can really have a large benefit. to make sure that, one, by tokenizing the securities, we can real-time settle transactions. We can already do that if you have view of the assets, of course. Mm-hmm. We already do that on exchange in a half tokenized world, I should say. But if you really want to settle securities between different exchanges, you need to have an infrastructure to do that on. Yep. We don't need a central counterparty anymore because we have real-time settlement, because there's no settlement risk. And we can onboard, and this is heaven, I think, for all the financial market players. We only need to KYC an investor once. We only need to onboard them once. We don't need to do that multiple times because we can just add an investor to a whitelist. And then we know that a licensed player in the market has done the onboarding of that investor. And why not reuse that by another player? I think what is one of the most interesting, and that's a new feature, and that's how you can trade the virtual basket in this new market and switching between multiple venues. And for that, I would like to hand over to Dion.
Yeah. Thanks, thanks, Marleen. Yeah, I think it's really, really interesting and exciting to see how this is actually changing the, or potentially showing an alternative route for, let's say, trading on capital markets. Yeah, tell us a little bit more about that from your perspective, Dion.
Yeah. So, if you want to transfer securities, traditionally you trade them one by one.
Yeah,
and we make two innovations. One is that you can basically automatically check that the party that you trade with is allowed to trade with you. that makes sure that we satisfy all the regulations surrounding financial markets. And the second one is that these ventures are kind of small. Small market capitalization. And if you then look in the market, liquidity for such ventures is usually very poor. Sometimes there is not even a party willing to offer any liquidity whatsoever. Yeah, usually it's a dedicated party, either by choice or by designation, that offers liquidity in the market. But for small stocks, penny stocks, you often see that is not the case. And there's several reasons for that. One reason is that there needs to be sufficient scale to justify fixed costs related to making a market in a security. If you can make a market in the vertical as a whole, you have 30 times the scale that you otherwise have. Now, second one is think about the reason I, as an owner, would come to you as an intermediary to trade a share. I may have better information than you have, and I would want to trade as much as possible of that specific share.
Yeah.
What I wouldn't want to do is to trade 30 shares at once with you if I have specific information in one share. There's too much other trading involved in that.
Yep.
So by allowing to trade this basket in one go, we get rid of so-called adverse selection risk. And because of that, for the intermediary, it's safer to trade and therefore transaction costs can be much lower and we get a more liquid market. Then a third concern for an intermediary is the risk of any trade he or she absorbs. That will stay in inventory. And that inventory is risky.
Yep.
Now, there are two components contributing to that risk. One is the riskiness of the security itself. And the other one is the duration over which this security is held on average in inventory. Over a longer period, that's more that can go wrong for this intermediary. So if I can trade a basket, it's more likely that a new opposite order comes in relatively soon.
Yep.
so the duration at which I hold inventory is shortened, and therefore risk is reduced. Moreover, the basket is diversified.
Yeah.
And therefore much less subject to venture-specific risk. And also for that reason, the risk of holding inventory for an intermediary is reduced, and therefore an intermediary should find it more profitable
to offer liquidity.
Yeah, to offer liquidity.
Yeah.
Now, in the end, that's beneficial for both investors as well as for ventures. Investors get better liquidity, so they can more easily get rid of their shares in case they need to for liquidity reasons. And ventures benefit from the fact that this is more appealing for investors, and investors might be willing to pay a bit more for their shares, because of which they can get better valuations.
Exactly, better liquidity, so less liquidity discount.
Exactly.
And do you also think it has a positive effect on new share issuance, for example? So if they would actually, if there is more liquidity, are you actually also more likely to raise another round by another issuance?
That depends on what happens after the vertical period, whether this opportunity to trade as a vertical, all the ventures that survived, that is, mm-hmm. Would continue to exist. As long as that opportunity continues to exist, that benefit would also persist. And also for subsequent rounds, indeed, you would have this reduced liquidity discount.
Yeah. I think it's really interesting. And so is it already, how are you involved in conversations with potential liquidity providers, market makers how are they looking into this?
We're not at that stage yet. Of course, we've been discussing in the group that has been coming up with ideas for that for the initiative that, among others, involves Marlene, who operates an exchange. So definitely there has been some feedback, but we would be most happy to hear more about market opinions on that.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. I think it fits very well in a trend most investors now looking much at ETFs, right? So in combined investments are becoming really popular, and indeed it could be structured in a fund, but this is just an alternative way of structuring it.
It is an alternative way of structuring with similar benefits.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, so I think that fits very nicely in the trend, as well as that what's, of course, the vertical that has been chosen right now on sustainability, of course, offers benefits as well, because I think it's one of the only verticals that kept on going even during the corona crisis, mm-hmm. Because there's just a lot of interest in investing in sustainability projects. So from that perspective already, it should get quite some appeal.
One thing I would highlight, what I would like to highlight, and that is specifically related to the way we use tokens, is because we use tokens, we can make these things smart. And that is really instrumental in fostering some of the benefits that we highlighted today. The whitelisting, we can do that by making tokens smart, by putting executable code into these tokens, and thereby it is impossible to trade a token with somebody that's not whitelisted, or to trade a token through an exchange that is not whitelisted. So you have very low supervisory cost, and the market can just trust on technology that is not operated by humans and paperwork and all the associated error-prone processes involved, that things go well.
Yep.
Having everything organized through tokens, in this case, administrated on a blockchain, also provides you an immutable trade record, which is also very easily audited. The idea of being able to trade the basket, you could do that actually with old technology. There have been batch order types, such as program trades in the US, that allow you to trade securities in a batch. We also discussed whether it would be possible to do this as an order type rather than as a smart token feature. The problem with doing that is that if you do that as a separate order type, it's exchange specific.
Yeah.
And you tie yourself to exchanges that offer that functionality.
Yeah.
Whereas if you make it native into a token, and then it works pretty much everywhere. Because what you do is you basically tokenize those 30 tokens temporarily, and then you have kind of a standard security that you can trade through any exchange framework. And once that security is transferred, some code executes, and all those underlying tokens move ownership as well.
Yeah. I think that's really interesting, because I think that's one of the really beneficial features here, is that indeed you could, these are individual investments, but for the sake of being able to trade them collectively, they get tokenized and transported as a whole. Yeah. Are there limitations to what kind of exchanges could handle this, for example, or could it basically be globally any exchange that could deal with equity?
Well. Currently, we're planning to for this tokenized token.
Yes.
or this tokenized basket of tokens, we plan to request a separate ISIN.
Okay.
So then it would, for the purpose of trading securities, be virtually identical to trading any other security. So it would be generic and therefore applicable to pretty much every exchange. Of course, the exchange should support the implementation on this blockchain ledger.
Yep. Yeah,
I think the most important player in this is the CSD. So without the CSD, this doesn't work. Yeah. Well, it's not only the CSD; it's all the licensed bodies in the capital market. So you need a broker. For retail investors, you need a CSD, and you need an exchange, and those three, and possibly a bank that holds cash, because there are also there's a cash lag in every transaction. So you need to have that set up to start with. Well, we already collaborate with ABN AMRO Clearing Bank, where the cash transactions are in fact already tokenized.
Yep.
And together with Euroclear, we're now developing a situation or a framework where we can actually manage the securities in a tokenized setting. And then we have both. And we have all the necessary players involved, and we really invite other exchanges to connect either to Euroclear or to make sure that they have a CSD that has a similar setup.
But it's interesting because this solves now a very particular problem around these ventures that are generally relatively small, so that sort of the collecting them together has a really specific benefit. But it is at the same time, it's an innovation in itself that could also have all kinds of other applications, I would assume.
Yeah, and that makes it dangerous, because there are so many opportunities that come out of it, and that's why we said no, we need to focus, we need to make sure that we make this work, and we can already do that with the existing licenses, with the existing platforms, with the existing technology that we have. We're lucky with what we already have in the Netherlands and what we already can do in the Netherlands. We can do this today. We don't need to wait until something changes or something gets built. So that is, I think, the huge benefit. And then, we will take it step by step as a country, and there will be other platforms, other ideas, creative things that will probably build onto what is there, as we've always been doing.
Yeah.
And the token setup actually may make things, especially from the CSD perspective, also a lot easier, because you have a much better overview of who owns what.
Yeah.
If you want to send out invitations for shareholder votes, you can directly deliver that to the wallets of investors, which lowers the hurdle to actually participate in these votes. The general attendance rate and voting rate at shareholder meetings tends to be low. So this is also a way of fostering involvement of investors.
Yeah, I think that's really an interesting part, but also maybe to tie into that, because you mentioned some parts of the tokens have a self-executable conditions, right? And they mostly relate to compliance, which I think is right.
So the whitelisting.
Exactly, the whitelisting option. But also several things are more manually, like for example, the stage gate approach with regard to investing. And so they're particularly not programmed into the tokens, right?
Yeah.
I think that's done on purpose.
That's done on purpose because we believe you simply cannot automate that kind of rule. Yeah. It would not be to the benefit of the investor and also not to the venture, but and therefore also not to the investor. What you can do is that only certain players with certain permissions can say, like, yes, this milestone is reached.
Yeah.
But the reaching of the milestone itself should not be programmed. That's what we believe, at least.
Exactly.
Because so things can change. For example, Corona. Who would have thought that that would happen? And in that case, if the vertical would have been running then the only thing that you would do is just extend the lifetime of the vertical.
Yeah.
And then you can just still go on. So, yeah.
I think that's a very good point. I think there's a lot of flexibility in written contracts because in the end people need to execute it and therefore are able to deal with various situations.
Yeah.
And I think that's one of the things that people find scary with regard to self-executing contracts.
Yeah.
Even though they do offer a lot of benefits, potentially like indeed keeping up compliance where there would otherwise be a very manual process.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe there are some more questions. Just want to check if any questions came in. I think it's really interesting to dive a bit deeper into the technology and the structure behind it. And I believe that there's a lot of potential, actually, and I think the way that you were able to solve the issue of the relatively small companies and trades and to solve for liquidity potential issues. So I'm really curious how, indeed, let's say the group is picking that up and moving this to the next level so we could actually see this in real life on the exchange hopefully soon.
Yeah.
Let's see, I think there are some questions if I look at it. We'll just wait for them to come in. Maybe Dion, to ask you. So what do you see, right? So I think generally you see that capital markets are very often seen as a relatively, let's say public capital markets are seen as a relatively expensive option for companies from multiple angles. So that has an administrative angle, but also a reputational angle. How do you see, let's say, is there anything that particular that these ventures need to do to be able to maintain their status as a public company in a proper way? Or is there anything else that you were able to think about to keep life simple for them?
I think the structure that is offered here allows them to focus on their product, and I think that that is really crucial. That was something that was mentioned earlier. You don't want a creative person that has a very good idea to be busy 80% of the time with fundraising and financial markets.
Yep.
And I think the simplicity of the structure that is set up, together with some exemptions because of the scale, and coaching and help from a program management would at least to a significant extent relieve that burden.
Yeah.
And maybe I can also add something to that. So all these ventures become publicly listed ventures, and there are actually two things that are very sensitive in being a publicly listed company. One is insider trading, or trading with knowledge that's not known by the rest of the market. And we can very easily manage that because we know who is on the other side of the transaction.
Yep.
So if you whitelist the insiders, then you can, before the trade even happens, already manage that. Yep. Make sure that they trade according to the insider trading rules, or exclude them completely from trading, or there could be blocking transactions. So that's one advantage. And the other advantage is so if you look to the if you look at the public domain, obviously all these ventures need to report. They need to report on their financials. They need to do that twice a year. But they do have a program manager that can service them in collectively doing that in a proper way, to set the administrations up front in a proper way, to have one a good auditor that audits these underlying firms. And then for the things such as, for example, notifying the market when a certain transaction happens, if a certain size is reached, we can already, because of knowing who is on the other side of the transaction, we can already prevent a lot of dangerous things that could potentially happen for small companies in the market. We can prevent them from happening and not later on need to do damage control. That is what Yeah, that's where we help the companies. Also in terms of communicating with their investors, there is a section in the platform where you can monitor the prices, where you can transact in the market, but where you can also, there's one place where you have all the documentation, all the communication that is shared with all the investors on one place, on one area, and that's hopefully helps these companies grow up.
Makes life a lot easier for them. Thanks. I think therewith we've already answered this question that's now on the screen. On the inside trading.
You could even make those securities so smart that they automatically report insider trading.
Yeah, that's definitely a nice next level where probably
that you have periods in which insiders can trade, and if they do so, then it's automatically reported. That's a form of embedded governance that you can achieve with such tokens.
Yeah, indeed. This is a nice question for you, maybe Marlene, to talk about whether only accredited investors are allowed to go into the secondary market.
The answer is everybody can participate. So as well as in the primary market, but also in the secondary market, it doesn't matter whether you are a small investor or a large investor. We expect that the majority, we already speak to professional investors or institutional investors, we expect that the majority block of the primary market transaction is probably picked up by one or two large professional investors. Why? Because to finance almost 29 million in a retail market with a new product, that will take some time before everybody gets used to it. But in the structure itself, it doesn't matter whether we expect that the nominal value is already very small, but the issuance prices will also be very low, so everybody can participate. And there will be a minimum investment boundary, which will probably not be higher than 1,000 euros. So that allows also the small investors to...
And that's on collective level, not on individual company level? Or
As an investor, you would be able to invest 1,000 euros over 30 ventures.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay. So,
And you probably, of course, have to do the regular investor onboarding, right? So you have to a certain qualification, whether the risk profile of investors, I think you have to do always. So.
Yes, all investors are automatically onboarded. Obviously, the institutional investors or professional investors have different onboarding to the exchange. But the investors that need to be onboarded through the broker go through the same onboarding street. And that, hopefully assures that these investors are investor fit to trade in this market.
Of course, yeah. Now, and of course, from that perspective, that people make wise investment decisions, or at least relate that to the rest of their portfolio in a certain, in a balanced way. Yeah. Are there examples of hybrid tokenized traditional structures? So have we seen this before? These actually kind of hybrid way of structuring capital markets. Have you seen them already?
I was surprised that Dion mentioned program trades, because that's what we are doing. But only the program trades at the moment are only accessible for very large investors. So that is from a legal perspective, and then we already do primary market transactions right now on exchange. We already facilitate capital raisings on exchange, and that works. And the only thing that's different for us is that instead of one IPO at a time, we do 30 IPOs at a time.
So indeed. So you really build on top of the state-of-the-art technology where we are, and take that to the next level. Yeah. And I think it's nice that indeed we're able to make the feature of doing a block trade from that perspective is actually more becoming available now also to retail investors, basically. Really nice.
Okay.
I think we should almost wrap it up. I think it becomes quite clear now that I think we've got a really nice proposition where you allow ventures to raise funding in a collective way, and therefore making it more accessible for investors on one hand, and at the same time making it easier for the ventures so that they're able to focus on building their companies, and therefore, creating a thriving, sustainable ecosystem, I think, based here in the Netherlands with the partners that you mentioned. It's very good, I think, to dive in deeper in the next seminar, which is the next one coming up again?
Yeah, the next seminar is next Thursday. It's all the seminars will be planned on this at the same time on each Thursday every next week.
Yep.
The next seminar is about the legal structure. So from the perspective of the investor, it's important that certain investor rights are captured in a proper way. Also for the venture's point of view, that it's not that it still remains flexible to do what it needs to do. We will have part of the masterclass will be dedicated to Dan Liebau. Who has and you might be able to share something about that, Dion?
Yeah, Dan Liebau together with two other academic co-authors, Thomas Lambert and Peter Rosenbaum, has done a study on success factors for security token offerings. Next webinar we will discuss with him. About their findings, the study, and how it relates to this initiative.
Yeah. Yes. Really nice. Yeah. Well, we're all looking forward to that, the next one. Dion, any other nice projects that you're working on at the moment that we should keep an eye out for?
Currently, this is the main one that I'm working on, at least in the tech. In the tech context.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for joining and giving your explanation about how this works on the back end. And well, thanks again for sharing, Marleen. I think it's really interesting. Thank you all for watching and being interactive with questions. Please keep them coming also afterwards because we might be able to pick them up in the next seminars. Thank you very much for now and enjoy your warm afternoon.
Yes.